Carr sought information for a living. That is to say that ever since he returned from Korea, after having served with the armed forces, he had been working as a private investigator in Montreal. William Hamilton, a rich industrialist, had gotten in touch with him regarding a simple vandalism issue. Nothing to write home about. Not worth hiring a private eye either, just so he can drive for hours on rough roads. But that's how it had always been. The client pays, Carl gets it done. They had set up to meet at the general store, his client's business. Well, actually, the entire village had William Hamilton's name written all over it. When the roads were bad, muddy, or snowed in, it was customary around these parts to close them off. But it was also customary to ignore those signs entirely and drive there anyway. Hamilton never mentioned a road-blocking barrier. Why was it needed here in the back of beyond? That would, however, be a mystery for another day. Carl had waited long enough for someone to come and raise it. Still not a soul in sight. There was no point in waiting any longer. Carl had to figure this one out by himself. Hamilton, no doubt, knew who managed the barrier. Carl wanted to give him a call, but that would have been too easy, though, as sure enough, the line was acting up. Hamilton is waiting for Carl in the general store. It was time for him to get down to business. William Hamilton enjoyed a lavish country house built in the very heart of the northern forests, not too far from here. The local populace was divided when it came to the affluent man. Some saw a wealthy philanthropist dedicated to improving the region's economy. Others an aging Englishman who would do anything to further his fortunes. And those ones hated him enough to go on about scheming against him. Hamilton had recently acquired a few local businesses, but the last straw was the reopening of a mine, which gave rise to a wave of protests and threats from the Cree people. Given these circumstances, Carl reckoned that a good number of people must be feeling compelled to oppose Hamilton in one way or another. So far, only the industrialist's house had been a target, but soon enough, Carl thought, the target would become the vandals. Needed to get out of there. The cold and the pain required urgent care. The driver had taken off. It was still best to check it out and leave nothing to chance. Carl needed help. It was a small, locked box engraved with the letters WH. Carl thought about taking it. Nothing was to be left to chance. Such heart-wrenching Nordic poetry, that was. But Carl didn't care much about flowery language. This deep in the country, his last hope was to find an abandoned garage or a farm by the roadside. His life depended on it. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. Ever diligent in his work, always carried his log on him, in which he scribbled down thoughts and leads alike during the course of his investigations. Spread out on a few acres of untouched forest, bellowing caribou, everlasting snow, and undefiled lakes, the Manistan region was no tourist hub. It was said to have been populated for millennia by Cree people, and ever since the industrial era, by the metal mining industry. The truck was running on fumes. Good thing that the general store was close by. The milkman had to drive by every week to fill the bottles. The fresh milk indicated a recent visit. Something fell to the bottom of the box. Carl had no trouble recognizing his employer. He had been killed. There was no need to be a detective to figure that out. But only a detective could have noticed that the killer had to have been very close. That the fatal blow had been given before the victim even realized. Carl felt a chill down his spine and had a terrifying realization. If Hamilton was dead, then who was going to pay him? What could be inside that envelope? Carl was taken aback. He knew this address. It was said to be the address of the P.O. box for the Canadian Secret Service. The note explained that the garage and the store couldn't be supplied with electricity at the same time. Maintaining his composure, Carl recalled something from his military training. Wolves always stay away from populated areas. Wait, was it about bears? Carl was no electrician, but he could identify a wiring problem when he saw one. Hate was in the air. Seems like some villagers barely tolerated each other. The flames won't grow without some help. Other materials were required. An explosion suddenly occurred outside. According to that log, it seemed like the whole village owed some money to the general store. Carl was far more interested in the bunch of nearby addresses he had just gotten his hands on, though. Carl knew that Gilles Lachance was in charge of the general store. That made him one of Hamilton's employees. A very angry employee, as Carl could plainly see. The snowstorm pummeled everything in its path. Carl was not surprised when he heard no tone. crowbar was stuck under the lift. Notwithstanding Carl's imposing stature, car lifting wasn't part of his skill set yet. Staring intently at the controls won't be enough to make that lift budge. The poor thing was out of power. Staring intently at the controls won't be enough to make that lift budge. The poor thing was out of power. At long last, the crowbar was within Carl's grasp. Surely it would come in handy at some point. The murder weapon. What was that doing there, Carl wondered. Hamilton must have been determined to keep some information secret to post this key. Shame he got unlucky. Everything made sense now. Poor Hamilton's denunciation was interrupted, and he figured it would be best to lock everything up and send the key to his correspondent, who would receive the box later on. Clever, but not enough. That's what happens to ordinary people playing spy. Carl knew straight away where to find the infuriated Gilles Lachance. Any good investigation would have to start there. Thank you. The Polaroid, Carl's long-standing and faithful ally, had seen a share of husbands caught red-handed. Carl wondered what the hell could that thing be. It looked like a man fossilized in ice. All of a sudden, Carl felt like he was pulled inside a world of dreams, a cold, unknown dimension. Somehow, self-control was slipping from his grasp. To all appearances, this was a hunting log. Better yet, a war diary. What could these engraved numbers mean? A fresh path suddenly appeared before Carl. Carl had that feeling you get when you immerse your frozen hands in hot water. What happened? Now at least he knew who the unfortunate man petrified in ice was. Gilles Lachance, the general store's manager himself. That had to be the worst parking job ever. Who was Carl to judge, though? It may be customary to park like that around these parts, or not. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. Thank you. There should be a law forbidding doctors from falling sick. In spite of Dr. Beaupré's goodwill, the place didn't look much like a physician's office. It could easily be mistaken for a sewing shop. For the one-eyed, or for other vision problems, the eye patch was the way to go. Carl got the trembles as he imagined the excruciating pain that kind of scalpel could no doubt inflict. Within these miserable walls, patients probably felt more like in a slaughterhouse than in a doctor's office. Someone had lost a few liters of blood here. Carl's first thought had been a lumber accident, someone's hand cut by a saw, or a hunting accident. In any case, whoever had lost all this blood couldn't have gone far. Perhaps they were already dead. A communist manifesto. Only a few years ago, this type of allegiance meant prison time. And even at present, the Western world was very wary of the Soviet threat. Why would the doctor own such a book? Dr. Beaupré had done his medical studies quite far from here. He was surely one of the first students out of the new campus to settle on the mountainside. There was no doubt that the doctor and Hamilton knew each other very well. The good doctor, flanked by his beautiful spouse. Pure happiness, captured on cardstock. Carl recognized this woman's soulful eyes. Was it Dr. Beaupré who had hit him head-on at the village border? Nobody kills a rich patient to start a revolution. It didn't make any sense. He had to dig deeper still to understand. Luckily, that was Carl Faubert's specialty. The injured could be recognized by the large stains of red, an informal nickname given to merbromen, smudged all over their injuries. A chamber pot. Fortunately for Carl, inspecting it wouldn't further this particular investigation. felt like he knew the doctor now. His belongings had spoken lengths about him. But what Carl had heard worried him.
Mon bonhomme. Je m'attendais pas à ce qu'un étrange retentisse par ici. Moi, te dire, je prends plus de chance depuis que ça rôde dans ce bout-là. J'ai ma carabine au bout du doigt, et puis bang, 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 si ça s'approche. Si tu veux du linge chaud, parce que t'es habillé comme un gars de la ville, je dirais pas non à une bonne bouteille de caribou. Puis tu pigeras ce que tu voudras parmi mes guenilles. C'est encore beau. Tout ce qui est vieilli est bien meilleur. C'est vrai, le jeune, que tu te promènes quasiment en bobette. Une bonne pelisse, ça te ferait pas de tort. Mais je vais te dire une chose. Dans ton coin de pays comme Paris-7, on n'a rien sans rien. Et où, mon caribou? Cadon, ça ouvre l'appentis. Prends-la, je m'en fous. Perds ton temps dans mes déchets tant que tu rapportes du caribou. Vois-tu le livre, là? C'est le Wendigo. Ouais, le Wendigo. Un guerrier qui devient un loup pour se venger de sa grosse peine. Et... Tu marches, tu marches, tu marches, tu sens des pieds. Gomme-moi la belle rose de la tulipe qui se donne au yob sur le mercredi des cendres. Si tu peux effrayer cette histoire-là. Hé, la Corriveau, Batèche, ça te passe l'envie de te marier, la Corriveau? Elle tuait tous ses maris, squeak, les uns après les autres. Pas de pitié dans le mariage. Ben oui, une couche. Tu peux-tu tout faire en même temps, toi? Hé, la Corriveau, Batèche, ça te passe l'envie de te marier, la Corriveau? À Tuette ou ses maris, squeak, les uns après les autres. Pas de pitié dans le mariage. Mon beau bonnet du beau temps. Puis ma ceinture, je vous aime.
An axe, not too shabby. Carl felt he needed to protect himself. Fed his mind, but had forgotten the harsh reality that his body also needed nourishment, especially in the dead of winter. The place looked more like a pigsty than a house. A heavy stench of curdled milk, cheap alcohol, and boiled cauliflower filled the air. Régin Blouin. Seems like that pig had a name after all. Rock music invaded the minds of men even in the remotest of places. The man didn't own a turntable, though, so there's that going for him. You had to be out of your mind to cook up white whiskey at home. The all-surrounding stench of alcohol alone was probably enough to gas a man to death. Carl knew right away that the owner of this place wasn't a copper collector. No, this was a junkman's base of operations. The guy definitely seemed like quite the expert in scavenging scrap metal, with or without permission, surely. In the right hands, red metal could sell like hotcakes. Back then, in Africa and elsewhere, people were ready to take up arms to stand against the yoke of English imperialism. In Montreal, mailboxes were blown up, abductions were carried out, and violent manifestos were distributed to media outlets. But around here, in the great northernmost, all a man could do is curse out loud against a faraway evil and pray for the revolution to arise. That man, by any reckoning, was from that very stock. With a homemade shooting range such as this, it wasn't hard to imagine a stray bullet ending its course inside the flesh of an unsuspecting passerby. Granted, Carl thought, there wasn't much in the way of passersby around here. That truck had obviously seen its share of gravel roads. Carl wasn't a mechanic, but he could easily tell that only the most heartfelt prayer would bring this old beater back from its slumber. With that cold, however, it was more likely that it would wait until next spring to wake up. Felt that it was mission accomplished with the wicked nectar in his hands.
exactement caribou pour revenir de même.
Oh, quand on cherche, on trouve. Parce que je t'aime bien, Aster, je vais te dire quelque chose. Tu fais bien de prendre ma pélisse. Parce que par là-bas, tu vas rencontrer le vrai froid. Un froid qui glace comme t'en as jamais connu dans ta vie.
Had been very generous to Carl. He couldn't have asked for more. Sometimes, and especially around here, people are so possessive with their land, as a dog is with hydrants. Was a motorless car. The mechanic sure had an odd way to go about repairing things. The milk was sorted by color, from the whitest to the greenest. Or in other words, from the freshest to the sourest. Carl had a hunch that there had got to be a plan somewhere that could help him put this thing back together. The man has a passion for intergalactic things. Back then, people were obviously scared of the Russian atomic bomb, but an invasion by extraterrestrials was a legit fear as well. Seems like the mechanic had made his choice. Roswell, Atamipek, same story. Large deserts conducive to extravagant follies. Carl deducted this was a map of the area. Were those pins pointing to places of interest? Weird stuff. Kind of a crossing between a colander and a hairdryer. What was it for? To play telepath? To protect against nuclear waves? If some daring person could manage to get their hands on the missing parts, Carl was willing to bet that the craft would have taken flight. These scribblings were undoubtedly the mark of a tormented mind. Something wasn't right in the poor mechanic's head. Another worrisome victim of this ice, this one seemingly petrified in action. The poor man, before being frozen solid, seemed to have been defending the entrance to his cabin. But from what? Something very important must have been in there for the man to take such time and effort to hide it. But Carl didn't know how to reach it. The week of October 5th, thought Carl. That was this week. The plug should have been here by now. The very first steps of man on the moon were made more than a year ago. The event had surely captivated the mechanic's mind for him to still keep this around. By following the plan, Carl was led to believe that the snowmobile's parts had to be scattered about in the vicinity. A bit of gas, a new spark plug, and the key, and this thing would run perfectly. All he needed to do now was to find all that. Carl had no idea how to interpret a message like that. On the surface, it seemed like he had one half too many of this puzzle. Enough to know he shouldn't take this testimony as gospel. The entire thing, being some punishment for a murder committed by Hamilton, seemed like an outlandish theory. Carl was doubtful. Carl still wasn't done with the mechanic's place. Carl was used to strange phenomena, but a chunk of ice like this? As if an iceberg came out of the ground? That was a first. Thought he would be dancing with the wolves. Thank you. That large antenna in the middle of the path, undoubtedly ideal in attempting to communicate with little green men, was quite awkwardly placed. There had to be a lever to control it, maybe behind it. Carl would have to figure out how to reach it. Electric terminals appeared to be linked together, but for what purpose? Carl rejoiced at the unexpected source of heat, but not as much as his freezing hands. So that's where the generator key was hiding. All that was left was to use it. Open sesame. At last, so big an effort for an oh-so-tiny piece of metal. Carl's scout training was buried deep in his memories. What do you need again to start a fire? an indisputable fact that machines like this entailed a level of intellectual finesse that Carl was lacking. Still frozen, and Carl had everything he needed, so he felt ready to leave. Like many of his contemporaries, felt like he had more trouble breathing when he wasn't smoking. Cigarette was his own personal breathing assistant. Carl's scout training was buried deep in his memory. What do you need again to start a fire? Never thought he would be dancing with the wolves. It was a classic Canadian house, except for the absent horde of kids that would normally be swarming about. the photograph was snapped not too far from here, Carl noticed. The couple seemed to be very good friends. Not a single weapon was left. All of them were gone. All manners of clothing were gone, as if the Droits drove out of town with their closet in tow. Just one more move and White is checkmated. Game over. It seems the game was abandoned right before the final strike came down. Simone de Beauvoir, Claude Lévi-Strauss, Hannah Arendt, Roland Barthes. Carl was surprised by the literature filling this liberal-leaning bookcase. Could there really be intellectuals dwelling in this far-off land? A picture of Wilfred in his youth. Carl figured right away that the man must have been some kind of wildlife officer. Thank you. true Catholic always strives to keep lowly temptations at bay. Obviously, Carl thought, someone in this house wasn't doing a good job at upholding the Holy Bible's teachings. Carl was no burglar. He didn't need to resort to petty techniques such as window breaking to find his way in. A good detective simply looks for keys where gullible souls hide them. What was even the point of locking your door, if everyone hid their key in the same place? Carl was starting to feel like his investigator life lacked challenge. The house smelled like incense, the kind that reminds you of the good Lord, of peace. Religion was very influential throughout Quebec many years ago. Indeed, it was surprising that Carl did not come across a single chapel since arriving here. The perfect cookie-cutter Catholic family, most likely attending church every Sunday. Who knew that giraffes thrived in the North Pole? The craze for toys was stupefying. Love of religion and ancestors was rooted deep inside the hearts of Canadians of old, to which the Bedards appeared to be closely related. The family's mother must have spent her days washing the filth off her kids' diapers. The empty cradle sent an eerie feeling down Carl's spine, as if minutes ago someone just grabbed the baby and made a run for it. Jean-Luc Bédard had without a doubt been the closest man in the village to William Hamilton, otherwise known as Uncle Willie. The Bedards had vacated the premises. Carl gathered they would be of no help. Dreamcatchers originated from First Nations legends. They were used to trap nightmares.
Thank you.
The crossbow bolt stuck into the wooden stairs reminded Carl of the arrow that was said to have hit Achilles' heel. But who was the intended Achilles this time? The air was freezing, right down to the bone. The otherworldly ice had struck again. The woman's hopes and dreams were frozen in eternity. Something was hidden under the stairs. The man grabbed his rifle. Carl felt a sense of dread in him. Perhaps their spousal relationship had been cooling down lately. It seemed like secrecy was commonplace in this house. The vision's veil was lifted, and he was back to reality. A reality in which Giselle, Jill's loving spouse, was motionless, frozen in ice. The pot was cold, and the stew inside wasn't cooked. It's likely that poor Giselle was slow cooking it before she got snapped. What a waste. Carl had seen that kind of safe before, with its double-layered security system blending letters and numbers. Its code couldn't be broken by the common burglar. The general store, along with several more infrastructures in the area, had been acquired by wealthy industrialist William J. Hamilton. Perhaps the village should be rechristened Hamiltown. It felt like old people were all these walls could see for years. The LaChances could hardly be blamed for wanting to freshen things up a bit. Beautiful portrait of Gilles and Giselle, bound together by the chains of conventional love. A nice white coating would restore the room to its charm of olden days. Many boxes scattered about. Carl didn't need to summon his detective training to quickly figure that the LaChances had just moved in. What a mess! Clearly, there was some major revamping work underway here. The place looked barely habitable. The cross looked after a marriage's well-being and served as a motivator to uphold the priest's sermons calling for more little worshippers on one hand and cautioning against guilty pleasures on the other. Indeed, the LaChances were still part of the God-fearing generation. Luckily, he had the coat to protect him from the biting cold. The cold seemed to be more brutal here than anywhere else. It seeped into bones and into every breath to get to the heart until it stopped. Carl needed to be dressed in warm clothes to survive. Carl's scout training was buried deep in his memory. What do you need again to start a fire? Another instance of this magic ice. What was this one doing, lying on the ground, so afraid? The plot thickened like water into ice. He had been running in fear from something creeping towards him, against which he couldn't do anything, only to end up like this, petrified and cold. It seemed as though Regin had been ready to take up arms and slay people like Hamilton. Could he have committed murder for his cause? Who could have gotten killed in front of his very eyes? Ice seemed to take over this place like mold. That wall wasn't there earlier. How was he going to get out of here? The ice, oddly, did not budge despite the powerful fiery blast. Something was definitely rotten in this place. A fire is as good as the materials used to create it. Carl suddenly felt observed. He was worried about a presence around him. No stone can withstand the force of dynamite. A fire is as good as the materials used to create it. The track was fresh. That meant the car sunk down just a little while ago. Now where the hell could the passengers possibly have gone? The crossbow bolts had the same origin. Carl was sure of it. Who was it? And more importantly, what was being hunted like this? There was only void where the road should be. Carl hated dead ends. He felt trapped. It was as if the road had drowned in the lake. He would have to find help by another road. Someone must have dropped this in a hurry, but whoever did was heading into the woods. Carl's tracking instincts were quickly kicking in. He was suddenly shivering. He was going back to the realm of visions. Carl had no issue recognizing the spirit-like figures, but he couldn't figure out what they wanted from him. The phantom, freed of reality's shackles, vanished in the forest. Earlier, Carl had witnessed a tragedy that befell it. Another phantom disappeared in the wilderness. Carl had seen what happened to it, too. A third phantom gently faded away. Carl noticed that as the cursed villagers finally left reality, he could feel a sense of unburdening exuding from them in an almost intimate way. The last phantom, lost in solitude up until now, joined the others in the forest's darkness, free at last to enjoy an eternal, well-deserved slumber. Carl was only beginning to understand the horror which had struck his village. He understood that the dead were piling up and that he couldn't help them by himself. The road was clear for him. He needed to push further north and fast to find help. Another diary. Carl felt like someone was trying to communicate with him. Or was it simply the result of happenstance? A fire is as good as the materials used to create it. Becoming increasingly convinced that this was not normal hunting. The game that was being tracked was fearsome, so much so that the hunter didn't dare approach it. What could it be? Found what he was looking for. He needed to get back on the road. Carl reckoned that the place was still inhabited less than 24 hours ago. His detective sense tingled, revealing to him, or was it the strong smell of wilderness in the air, that there were most likely two men. Pierre the Poacher Bleh was definitely not the one who lived here. Indeed, Carl learned earlier that the man had recently been shredded to death by, allegedly, beasts. There should be a rifle hanging there. Its owner may not be very far. Two blankets. There were doubtless two people here, Carl reckoned. The jacket was still soaking wet. The poor man had, surely unwillingly, had a taste of the pond's water not too long ago. According to the pay stub, that poor man was Alexandre Bleh. door had been busted down violently, and a burnt smell filled the air. Half of the cabin had been consumed by flames. Carl surveyed the chaotic scene, noticing that someone appeared to have intended to use the furniture as bonfire fuel. Carl had no idea how such a mess could have occurred, but he knew it didn't bode well. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. Two more victims of this ice plague. Carl felt a chill down his spine. What if he was next? Felt the strong pull of a vision overcome him. A young woman. It looked like a simple hunting accident. There was Hamilton. Carl recognized him. A major hunting accident. The doctor examined the young woman. Death couldn't be overturned. She was dead. It was not the type of body you buried in a big ceremony in the village graveyard. It had to be hidden. No one could know about this. The best way to do that was to have a simple-minded man bury the poor girl, Lamotte, the mechanic. The doctor denied the unfair death of the young woman, but Hamilton had him in his grip. Hamilton knew all of the poet's secrets and wouldn't hesitate to reveal them. I know all about your crimes, you little communist. You know mine. What a sordid affair. Understood the ins and outs of the affair. A woman had been killed in an unfair accident, and a young warrior had damned himself to avenge her. But Hamilton, the one responsible, had already been killed. And so the beast could not quench his thirst for vengeance. And now, recklessly, Carl had pulled the bolt from the beast's cottage. A beast who was but a young free man lost without his fiancée, and who had, out of hatred, become Wendigo. we've sheltered him, but for how long? Scratches did not stop Carl. His mother would be so proud. Disappeared, so did Purity. I would defend Purity against the winds, the tides, against ice and blizzard. Could it be that all this was but a story of justice and vengeance? The soulful doctor, avenging his fiancée's unjust death by avenging this young woman as though she was his lover. Are these passionate feelings not precisely the kind of feelings that could cause a storm, petrify people deep inside, create monsters?